Hello everybody and welcome again to TalentSprint. We continue with the video presentations on the various financial intermediaries and capital market intermediaries. We have already seen what are mutual funds and what are insurance companies, life and non-life. Now we move on to the next segment of this presentation on the financial intermediaries and capital market intermediaries, and this one is on merchant banking. You might have heard of the term merchant banking at different points of time in your career, and we'll understand merchant banking much better in this video presentation. What is merchant banking? A merchant bank is a financial institution providing capital to companies in the form of share ownership instead of loans. Basically, merchant banks arrange for capital ownership. That is a simple definition of merchant banking. And anybody who does merchant banking activities is called a merchant banker. A merchant bank also provides advisory on corporate matters to the firms in which they invest. They also provide advisory services to corporates in which they invest. Merchant bankers help their clients in raising finance by way of issue of a debenture, shares, bank loans, etc. This is the most important function of a merchant banker as is known in India at this point in time. Merchant bankers are known to provide help to their clients in raising finance by way of either share capital or debentures or bank loans. They are called the arrangers to the loans, or they are called the arrangers to the issue, and these are the merchant bankers. The role of a merchant banker is very clear. The primary role is to raise finance. The primary role of a merchant banker is to raise finance for his client. They also do promotional activities. Whenever a company goes in for an IPO or an initial public offer, they have to inform the public that they are coming out with the offer of a share. And for this purpose, they do a lot of road shows in various cities, hold meetings and tell the investing public that this company is coming out with shares of this much amount for so much of number of shares, etc. And these meetings are all arranged by the merchant bankers. The promotional activities are also handled by them. Apart from helping the client to raise finance, they also help the clients in conducting promotional activities for the fundraising campaigns. They also act as brokers in stock exchanges. Merchant bankers also act as brokers in stock exchanges. They do project management. What is project management? Project management is nothing but analyzing a project right from the conceptual stage till the time the project goes on stream. That could involve technical analysis of the various aspects connected with the project. That could involve infrastructure aspects connected with the project. That could involve, more importantly, the financial aspects connected with the project. And the merchant bankers are with the corporate clients right from the stage of conceptualization of the project till the time the project actually takes off the ground and it becomes a reality. So to that extent, a merchant banker is a friend of the corporate right from the conception of the child to the childbirth. That is the analogy I can use. Right from the conception to the childbirth, he is with the corporate client. So the project management is also an integral part of the merchant banking activities. They also advise on modernization and expansion. It's not enough if the project takes off the ground. There could be many, many occasions when the project has taken off the ground very well and the company would like to go in for a modernization or an expansion plan. A modernization or an expansion plan invariably is accompanied by need for finance. And here again, the merchant banker comes to the issue, comes to the rescue. The merchant banker will say that, okay, I will arrange for you for finance for this modernization and expansion, either by issuing fresh public shares or by issuing right shares and bonus shares and so on, so that the people can, normally when a project takes off the ground and does well, the confidence of the investing public in that project goes up. When the confidence goes up, they are prepared to invest again. They are prepared to invest more money into the project. And that is where the merchant banker comes to the help and says that I will arrange for these additional funds as well. So apart from project management, which is at the initial stage of a corporate's life, modernization and expansion come at a later stage when the company has done well enough in the first phase and when they want to expand and when they want to modernize with the help of newer technology, which all means newer investments, which all means additional investments. And these additional investments are brought in by the merchant bankers through the various forms such as issuing fresh shares or issuing rights issued to a share or issuing bonus shares or issuing fresh debentures and so on and so forth. And of course, the majority of the work of the merchant banker is the managing the public issue. The merchant banker is supposed to raise funds from the public for the corporate in which to which he is contracted. And that issue is called the public issue or the initial public offer. The merchant banker does the initial public offer business very well. He's supposed to do the merchant banking part of it. He's supposed to do the raising the money from the public, or he's supposed to manage the public issue very well. That's a very, very important role of a merchant banker in a project. And of course, they also arrange for credit syndication. What does credit syndication mean? Credit syndication is nothing but meeting the needs of the corporate from a lender. That is the meaning of credit syndication. They syndicate credit. They arrange for credit. The finance arrangements can either be in the form of issuing of shares and debentures, or in the form of loans from banks and other public loans from bank and other financial institutions. And that is called credit syndications. Merchant bankers are very, very important in the role of credit syndication, because they help the corporate concern to get money from not only the public by way of shares, but also by from banks by way of loans. And not only banks, but also other private institutions and private lenders too. That is called the credit syndication part of it. So a merchant banker plays a very important role there as well. And of course, the merchant banker also handles the government concern for industrial projects. As a part of the project management, a lot of approvals have to be obtained from various government agencies, including environmental clearance, including electricity board clearance, including water board clearance, and so on and so forth. A project consists of getting government clearance from a different variety of government departments. And the corporate cannot be expected to go to each and every government department, knock at the door and get the approvals concerned. It is the duty of the merchant banker to ensure that he handles all the government approvals. He will be having a good liaison with the different government departments of the different government agencies. And he goes ahead and talks on behalf of the corporates. He presents the project report to them, and he ensures that the various approvals are maintained. So the various approvals are obtained so that the project takes off to a smooth start. This is a very important role of a merchant banker. And of course, they also ensure that special assistance is given to entrepreneurs and small companies. Merchant bankers are not necessarily only friends of the large corporate houses. They also extend their help to one-man entrepreneurs and sometimes even small companies as well. The main role of a merchant banker is in raising finance. Merchant bankers help their clients in raising finance by way of issue of a share or a debenture or bank loans, etc. They tap both the domestic and the international markets for this. Merchant bankers are known to have huge contacts outside the country as well. And so they will travel abroad to these countries and meet with the prospective investors, present the project report to them, and ensure that loans are arranged or investments are taken from the foreign institutional investors as well, or foreign investors as well, for the project which is supposed to take off in India. So they handle both domestic as well as international financing. Finance raised by this method may be used for commencing a new project or for expanding the existing one. In India, merchant bankers play the role of a promoter of an industrial enterprise. Basically, they are nothing but or virtually the promoter of an industrial enterprise, although they do not own the industrial enterprise themselves. But they virtually play the role of the promoter of an industrial enterprise, because they do everything from conceiving the project, preparing the project report, taking the government approvals, talking to the creditors either by way of bank loans or other credit syndications, and then managing the public issue and getting the money raised from the public by way of shares or debentures. So the entire gamut of a project is handled by a merchant banker in as much as the owner of the enterprise himself would do. That is why the merchant banker is actually playing the role of a virtual promoter of an industrial enterprise. He is playing the role of a virtual promoter. They help entrepreneurs in conceiving ideas, identifying projects, preparation of feasibility reports, getting government approvals, as well as incentives, etc. As I told you, the merchant bankers are involved right from the conception of the project stage till the childbirth. So this means that, which means that they have to be involved at every stage. They prepare the, they talk to the company concerned, understand the project very well. They have a series of meetings with the company officials, understand the project very well, then prepare a project report or a feasibility report. How feasible is this project? Can it get off the ground? And if it gets off the ground, will it do well? Does the market support this kind of a project or not? Is the market conditions favorable for starting of this project at this point of time or not? So they do all that analysis. They also present the project to investors and the government agencies. They handle the approvals. They handle the incentives part also. The incentives part from the government come because certain areas are identified as backward by the governments, by the central government or the state government concerned. And if somebody starts an industry in an identified backward location, the company will get incentives from the government for starting that project in that location. That aspect is also handled by a merchant banker. Merchant bankers may at times, not always, may at times also provide assistance in financial and technical cooperations and in joint ventures. They also do joint venture projects for the corporate clients, and they also do provide assistance in financial and technical collaborations. There could be an instance where, for example, a company needs a collaboration with a foreign firm. There could be an instance, for example, where a company needs to import machinery from abroad. Not only import machinery, but also import technical know-how. The merchant bankers, in some cases, also arrange for this kind of a technical cooperation or a technical collaboration with a foreign company. So that also is there, and they also arrange for joint ventures. It could be that the project cannot be handled by a single promoter. It needs to be handled by one or more promoters. In that case, the joint venture is entered into, and a merchant banker is very much a part of getting these joint venture agreements drawn up, vetted, and finally signed. Merchant bankers buy and sell shares in the stock exchange on behalf of their clients. They also act as brokers in the stock exchange. So to that extent, merchant bankers buy and sell shares in the stock exchange on behalf of their clients. This is an ongoing process. This is an ongoing process where sometimes the owners or the promoters may decide to offload a certain portion of their shares in the company so as to bring down the promoter's share. And this could either be done by the promoters themselves or they could be asked to do so by the lending institutions. So it's not always nice to have one promoter or one set of promoters holding the entire shares to himself. Then it becomes virtually a sole proprietorship. Then very little is left for the public to gain from that. So sometimes the promoters decide to dilute a part of their stake. So when they decide to dilute a part of their stake, that they have to sell the stock in the stock exchange, and that is also handled by merchant bankers. They additionally conduct researches on equity shares. As I told you, they are a comprehensive institution. A merchant banker is a comprehensive institution. To that extent, they conduct equity shares research. They actually do research on how well the share will do, what should be the right pricing for this share, when the share issue has to commence, when the share issue has to be, is the time in the market the right time for issuing these shares, and so on. So they do a lot of research on the equity shares. They also advise clients on the share to be purchased, the time of purchase, the quantity of such shares to be purchased, and also the time for selling these shares. It's not necessary that the owner should be doing the share purchase only in his firm. He could also be buying and selling shares of other firms. So the merchant banker also provides this kind of an assistance to the promoter of a corporate enterprise, saying that, boss, you not only carry on your own business, but as a part of your investment strategy, also buy and sell shares of other companies. And the merchant banker plays a very active role in advising these clients on when to buy and when to sell such shares of other companies as well. Merchant bankers offer help to clients in several ways in the process of project management. Project management is a very, very important aspect of an industry's or of a corporate's lifespan. The lifespan actually begins from conceiving the project and project management starts at the conception stage itself. They offer advice regarding the location of the project. As I told you, certain backward areas get government incentives, and if the location of the project is good enough for this kind of a project, they should not advise the wrong way. For example, let's talk of a granite factory. They have to be located in areas where granite quarries are there. They cannot be located in metropolitan cities. The registered office of the company can be in the metropolitan city, but the factory obviously cannot be in the metropolitan cities because metropolitan cities would not have granite quarries in them. So they have to be very careful in advising the client about the location of the project. For example, in a granite company, they have to advise the client to go in for locating the factory in a place which is very close to or which is in a place where there are granite quarries. So they advise the client in location of the project. Preparation of the project report, as I told you, is a humongous task. Preparation of the project report is virtually the major task of a merchant banker, because a project report takes several months to prepare, because each and every aspect of a corporate's birth till the time it takes off as a project is contained in the project report. And the merchant bankers play a very, very important role in preparing a detailed project report which will appeal to all sections of the people who want to invest in that project. And they carry out feasibility studies as well. They carry out whether this project is going to be feasible or not. If it is not feasible, they have to tell the client, look here, your project is not feasible, so let us not go ahead with that. Or if it is feasible, they have to tell the client as to how it is going to be feasible. And that feasibility studies will also be made known to the investors so as to raise their confidence in a particular project. And they plan out the financing of the project, tapping sources of such finance. The financing of the project has to be tied up. The cost of the project and the source of funds have to match. If there is a mismatch, then the project will never take off. Or even if it takes off, it will have an unnatural death very soon. So the cost of the project and the sources of the project, the sources of funding, have to match each other. And that matching each other is done by the merchant banker. He should prepare the project report showing what is the cost of the project. Let's say the cost of the project, for example, is 200 crore rupees. He has to exactly tell the promoter how he will raise that 200 crore rupees. Whether part of it will be raising from the promoter's own capital, it could be from the promoter's own capital, or it could be from issue of debentures to clients, or it could be raising a public issue and raising shares in the market, or it could be raising money from foreign institutional investors, or it could also mean raising money from banks by way of credit syndication, or it could also be raising money by way of shares issued to the general public in the form of a public issue. So the merchant banker has to prepare the cost of the project and prepare the sources of this project, and the cost of the project and the source of funding has to exactly match each other. There cannot be any cost overrun, and if there is any cost overrun, it has to be provided for in the project report itself. Cost overrun could be due to delays of several kinds. Weather could play a part, government approvals could play a part, imports could play a part, and getting the required manpower could play a part. So anything can result in a cost overrun in a project. So the project management or the project report has to provide for cost overruns also. And they also have to be built into the cost of the project, and the funding has to be arranged in such a way that the funds sourced will match the cost of the project. There should not be any mismatch. And that work is done by a merchant banker. So they are a very important financial intermediary in the financial intermediation system. They get information regarding government incentives and concessions. I told you a lot of incentives and concessions are provided by government for locating projects in certain specified backward areas. The central government also provides, the state government also provides. Some of them, sometimes either the central government or the state government, sometimes the central government and the state government provide for concessions and incentives. So the merchant banker's role is to assess these incentives and concessions from the government and include them in the source of funding so that the source of funding will match that of the cost of the project. Merchant bankers also advise on modernization and expansion. They advise on amalgamations, mergers and acquisitions. It could so happen that the company for which the project is project report is prepared has done very well. Then they want to do some take over some other company as well as a part of their mergers and acquisitions policies. So it is the role of the funder, it is the role of the merchant banker to analyze and advise the client on whether he can go ahead and do these mergers and acquisitions or not. Or it could also mean amalgamating this company with the parent company. The project might be prepared, for a division of a major company. After some time, the major company's promoters might decide to amalgamate the unit into the parent company itself. Then the merchant bankers have to prepare a project report for that amalgamation also. So they advise the clients on amalgamations, mergers, and acquisitions. They also advise the clients on takeovers, foreign collaborations, diversification of business, technology upgradation, and joint ventures. Each of these is very important. Takeovers, as I told you, the company might decide to take over another company in the same field so as to gain economies of scale. There have been any number of instances where takeovers have happened, where takeovers have happened and the company has become large in size. That could happen very easily. So the takeovers could involve certain expenditure on the capital front. The merchant bankers has to advise the client on how to take over, when to take over, and at what cost to take over. That also they have to advise the client. So takeovers they'll have to do, foreign collaborations, as I told you, it could be import of machinery, or it could be import of technical know-how itself, or it could be a joint venture with a foreign collaborator himself. There are any number of Indian companies which are having collaborations with foreign partners. The names are endless. The names are endless. So to that extent, I don't want to quote examples because there are every there is a foreign collaborator in practically every company today in India today, either directly or indirectly. So which means that foreign collaboration might involve either a technical know-how or an import of machinery also. The merchant banker has to be advising the client on these foreign collaborations. And then diversification of business is also important. The owner or the promoter should not diversify into unrelated businesses. It is the duty of the merchant banker to guard him to not to diversify into unrelated businesses. At the same time, it is also the duty of the merchant banker to advise the client on how well he can diversify within the related sphere of activity itself. To give you an example, there could be a leather company, manufacturing, let's say, shoes, for example. Diversification of that company might be into leather apparels and garments because they already have exposure in the leather field by manufacturing shoes, and they could be advised to diversify into manufacturing of leather garments and apparels, which are very much in demand abroad. So the merchant banker's duty is to advise the client, look here, you are a leather company, don't diversify into making films, or don't diversify by trying to run an airline company. That is not your core competency. Your core competency is leather. So diversify into allied fields. Allied fields are maybe leather apparels and shoes, and they could have a great demand in foreign countries. So it is the merchant banker's responsibility to identify such diversification projects, and besides identifying such diversification projects, advise the client on which are these projects in which he should diversify. And of course, technology plays a very, very important part in today's world. So the merchant banker should advise the client on what kind of technology should he use to in order to gain the optimum utilization of his money and resources. And of course, joint ventures, technology upgradation is very important. Technology upgradation, it could so happen that, again, coming back to the example of the leather company, they could be perhaps using outdated technology in their manufacture of leather shoes. Now, in order to upgrade them into the latest version, the merchant banker should introduce them to the latest technology upgradations available in the market, and they should convince the promoter that this kind of a technology upgradation will help them in the process of increasing their sales and increasing their revenue and thereby increasing their profits as well. So the merchant banker plays a very important role there also. On the public issue, which is perhaps the most important part of a merchant banker's work. The merchant bankers provide the following on the public issues. First of all, they advise the promoter on the timing of the public issue. The timing of the public issue has to be pinpointedly correct. You cannot go to the market when the sentiments are very low. You cannot go into the market when the sentiments are low because the investor's confidence is already shaken, and any new venture coming out at that point of time will meet with a lukewarm response or perhaps no response at all. There have been many, many cases where issues have been undersubscribed because the sentiments were not right at that point in time. So the timing of the issue is very important. The merchant banker should identify the right time and tell the promoter, look here, this is the ideal time for you to go in for a public issue. So the time has to be decided by the merchant banker. And the size of the issue as well. He has prepared a project report in which he has said the cost of the project is 200 crore rupees. He has also prepared a source of funding to match the 200 crore rupees. And out of the 200 crore rupees, the merchant banker could have perhaps arrived at in the project report by saying out of the 200 crore rupees, 100 crore rupees will be met by the public offer of shares. So he has to tell the promoter, look here, out of the 200 crore rupees, I will get you 100 crore rupees from sources such as credit syndication or, you know, foreign institutional investors and so on. And of course, you have to provide for a part of the 100 crores by yourself from your own money. But the remaining 100 crores, I will get you from the public issue. So he has to tell what is the time of the public issue, what is the best time, and the size of the public issue also, he has to advise the promoter. Of course, let us also understand, before we proceed further on this subject, let's understand that merchant banking is advisory in nature. He does not take decisions on behalf of the promoter. He is only playing the role of an advisory. An advisory cannot decide. He only suggests. He only recommends. So the advisor or the merchant banker advises the client on the timing of the issue, and he also advises the client on the size of the issue. Ultimately, it is left to the promoter to decide, no, I will not raise 100 crores from the public. I will raise only 80 crores. The remaining 20 crores I will pump in myself. Jolly well good, there is no issue. So the merchant banker cannot say, no, you must raise 100 crores from the public. He is only giving a suggestion or a recommendation that the source of funds can be met with by 100 crores from the public issue. Ultimately, the promoter decides. Merchant banker is an advisor. His role is purely advisory in nature. And of course, the price of the issue also is decided by the merchant banker or is suggested by the merchant banker. Merchant banker helps in deciding the price. At what price should the shares be offered? Should it be at a price of 10 rupees or should it be at a price of 10 rupees with a premium of 120 rupees? Or should it be at a premium? Should the price of the share offered, should be the face value should be at 10 rupees with a premium of 500 rupees and so on? And today we have the book building process in a public issue. The book building process invites quotations from the various bidders and the price is built accordingly. So the merchant banker has to decide what will be the lowest bid which they can accept, below which they will not be able to accept the offer of purchase from an investor. So the price of the issue also plays an important part in a public issue. And they have to act in the capacity of a manager to an issue. In other words, they have to manage each and everything that is connected with the public issue. And they have to also assist in receiving applications as well as allotment of securities. So the merchant banker's role does not end with the announcing of the public issue. He also has to, through his various branches and all that, accept the applications and finally has to allot the shares and securities. It could be shares or it could be debentures. It could be convertible debentures. It could be non-convertible debentures. It could be a rights issue. It could be a bonus issue or it could be an initial public offer. So they have to play a role in accepting the applications and in the allotment of securities as well. And of course, the merchant bankers also have to appoint the brokers and underwriters to an issue. Who are brokers? We all know, the one who actually do the broking part of it. Who are underwriters? We will see in the next video as to who are underwriters. Underwriters to an issue are very important. Underwriters are the people. Let me introduce you to that phrase right now. Underwriters are people who basically guarantee that the amount of money will be subscribed. And in case the money is not subscribed by the public, they themselves will put the money. That is called underwriting. This is a very simple definition of underwriting. We'll of course deal with underwriters in a separate video, but this is the introduction to the underwriting part of it. So the merchant bankers appoint the brokers and underwriters to a public issue. And they also, once the shares are allotted and the allotment of the shares happens smoothly, they have to ensure that the shares are listed on the stock exchange, because in a public issue, the process is not complete until the shares are listed on the stock exchange, for which a lot of approvals have to be taken from the stock exchange. That by itself is a demanding task. So the merchant bankers have to actually sit with the stock exchanges, meet them, and arrange for listing of the shares on the stock exchange. That itself is a very demanding part, let me tell you. It's not so easy, because the public issue, once it's completed, the public will then begin to await expectedly what is the date of listing and what is the price at which it's going to be listed. These two are very important from an investor's point of view. Supposing I have invested the shares of a company, of any company for that matter, at a price of, let's say, 200 rupees. I would wait for the listing announcement to be made so that I would know what is the opening price. And if the opening price is less than 200 rupees, I will feel disheartened, because then on the day one, I suffer a loss. Having invested 200 rupees per share, and if the shares are listed at 190 rupees, then I suffer a 10 rupee loss per share. So on the other hand, if the shares are listed at, let's say, 240 rupees, that means there is a 20% premium, I'll be only too glad. I'll be only too glad as an investor. So the duty of the merchant banker is not only to get the applications and allot the shares, but also to arrange for their listing on the stock exchanges, whether it's to be listed only on the Mumbai Stock or the Bombay Stock Exchange, or whether it's to be listed only on the Madras Stock Exchange or the Kolkata Stock Exchange or the Delhi Stock Exchange, or should they list it on the National Stock Exchange should they list it in all the stock exchanges in the country. Those all things have to be decided by the merchant banker, and he has to advise the client accordingly, so that the necessary steps are taken by the client to get the shares listed on the stock exchange. When I say the necessary steps are to be taken by the client, the guy who actually takes these necessary steps are the merchant bankers themselves. In credit syndication too, merchant bankers play a very important role. A merchant banker provides specialized services in the stages of preparation of a project. And the loan applications required for raising of the short-term and long-term credit from various banks and financial institutions as well. As I told you, the project management will detail what is the cost of the project and the sources of funding. And one of the sources of funding could be credit syndication from commercial banks and other private and other financial institutions. And the arrangement of loans from the banks could be either a short-term working capital or a long-term term loan. We have already seen in the bank video presentations what is a working capital or a cash credit loan and what is a term loan for the purchase of machinery, etc. I request you to go back to those videos and refresh your memory on what is a term loan, what is a cash credit, etc. So the merchant banker's role also extends to credit syndication, whereby he sits down with the bankers to the company and arranges for short-term either working capital requirements or long-term loans so that the cost of the project is met right at the beginning. And of course, not only from banks, but other institutions as well. They help in managing euro issues and raising funds abroad. Euro issues are those issues which are raised from, where the money is raised from European countries. They have a lot of technicality about them, and euro issues are very, very technical to handle because they involve more than one country. We should not forget the fact that euro is a currency of the European Union, which consists of several countries such as Germany, France, Switzerland, Netherlands, and so on. So it involves collaboration with different countries. It involves coordination with different countries. And so the euro loans are a specialized lot. and the merchant bankers have to specialize themselves in euro loans and getting money from abroad. If it's from a single country, it's that much easier. But euro loans means that they are sourced from different countries. So to that extent, the role of the merchant banker is even more important. A merchant banker completes all formalities for his or her client about government permission to expand and modernize business, which is necessary for companies, and commencing new businesses, which is necessary for business people. And a merchant banker also advises entrepreneurs and small companies on the availability and existence of business opportunities. They also get them acquainted with concessions, incentives, and government policies. We have already discussed this. They help clients to take advantage of this option available to them to the best of their capabilities. And they also provide certain other services. Merchant bankers provide services to the public sector undertakings as well. It's not that merchant bankers are working only with the private sector organizations. They also arrange to provide services for the public sector organizations as well. They help in revival of sick units. Supposing a public sector bank has financed a project and the project has gone sick, the merchant banker will step in and help the public sector bank to revive those sick units by support, by preparation of a fresh project report and telling the banker how they can work together with the company concerned and ensure that the sick unit is revived. They also do portfolio management for sick units. They also do corporate restructuring. What is restructuring? Restructuring is nothing but restructuring of a loan. Instead of being the loan being paid in 10 years, they restructure it in such a way that they are paid back in 15 years' time. That is called restructuring. They work with the bank and ensure that the loan is not to be repaid within 10 years, but the loan is extended for a further period of 5 years, and that process is called the corporate restructuring. And of course, they also do money market operations, like buying and selling of government securities and so on. They do money market operations for the public sector units as well. And a lot of merchant bankers also do leasing and financing services. They have enough capital with them, so they lease out machinery to the corporates concerned. And they also do financing part of it. A few merchant bankers are also known to have actually financed projects before, besides advising them on the project feasibility, etc., etc. One of the sources of funding could be the merchant banker's own funds itself. And of course, they service issues. They service issues for the public sector units as well. There are various types of merchant bankers in the country. The category one merchant banker is an advisor, issue manager, consultant, portfolio manager, and underwriter. Advisor is being an advisor. Issue manager is one who manages the public issues. Consultant, of course, he prepares the project report, feasibility report, and consults with the government agencies, etc., etc. He's involved in all the stages. Portfolio manager, he does portfolio management services for his client, and of course, underwriting. Underwriting also sometimes done by the merchant banker, and a guy who does all these activities together is called a category one merchant banker. Category 2 merchant banker does the role of a consultant, advisor, portfolio manager, and underwriter only. He does not do the role of an issue manager. He's classified as a category 2 merchant banker. And a category 3 merchant banker does even lesser activities. He just advises on the projects. He underwrites and consulting only. He does not do the public issue management, or he does not do the portfolio management services on behalf of his clients. So these are the three types of, these are the three categories of merchant bankers available in India today. Category one are the large merchant bankers. I can roll out some of the names. For example, it could be SBI Capital Markets. SBI Capital Markets is a very large merchant banker. They do from A to Z of merchant banking. Category one is, for example, it could be a SBI Capital Markets, or it could be any other private sector merchant banker themselves. Category two and category three are also there. And of course, there are category four as well. They do only advising or consulting to the issue of capital. They don't do portfolio management. They don't do issue management. They don't do advisory services. They don't do any of those things. They do only two things, which are advising and consulting to the issue of capital alone. They do an advisory role and they do a consulting role for the issue of capital alone. Beyond that, they don't do anything. And the SEBI passed the Merchant Bankers Regulations in 1992, on the following aspects of merchant banking. First of all, they have to be authorized by SEBI. Every merchant banker has to be registered with SEBI. SEBI, in case you have forgotten, is the Securities Exchange Board of India. So SEBI authorizes merchant bankers to carry on the role of a merchant banker. They give them a license. SEBI grants them a license to carry on the activities of merchant banking. They also classify merchant bankers into category 1, 2, 3 or 4. It is SEBI which classifies the merchant bankers depending on their role in a project. They categorize them into category 1, 2, 3 or 4. SEBI has also prescribed the capital adequacy norms of a merchant banker. The category 1 merchant bankers have to have a minimum capital of 5 crore rupees. Below that, they cannot be a category 1 merchant banker. And besides prescribing the capital adequacy norms and besides granting them a license and besides classification of these merchant bankers into category 1, 2, 3 or 4, SEBI has prescribed a code of conduct for the merchant bankers saying that they shall do the following things and they shall not do the following things. This is part of the SEBI's control and monitoring of the merchant bankers' role in the various companies for which they work for. And of course, SEBI has said that each merchant banker should compulsorily appoint a compliance officer to go into the various aspects of functioning of the merchant bankers. So this is also a very important part of the SEBI norms. So this is what I have for you in the video on merchant banking. We have seen the comprehensive view of who is a merchant banker, what are his roles and what are his various matters to be handled by him. We have seen what are the various kinds of categories of merchant bankers. We have seen how the merchant bankers involved right from the stage of project management or project conception till the time the project takes off. Not only after taking off, they also advise the clients on modernization and expansion. They advise the clients on raising of additional money. Sometimes the merchant bankers themselves underwrite the issue. They themselves agree to put money in case the public issue fails. Sometimes the merchant bankers also give loans to the companies they work for. So we have covered the entire gamut of merchant banking. I hope you enjoyed watching this video, and I'm sure it's going to be very, very useful for you in your career as bankers. So a merchant banker is a very important financial intermediary in our country, not only in our country, anywhere else in the world also. So the one important segment of the financial intermediation or the capital market intermediation is coming in the form of merchant bankers. I thank you for watching this video, and I hope you enjoyed watching it in as much as I enjoyed in making the presentation. Until I see you in the next video with some other topic, is bye from me for now. Thanks for watching, and please continue to keep watching TalentSprint videos. Thanks and bye.